You know, the wonderful thing about fishing is that whether it's a garbage collector or an executive, on the river, there are equals. Nobody cares what profession you have. It's the guy with the biggest catch who is the superior.
The story of Abu Garcia doesn't begin with the company itself. It starts with a boy named Henning Hammerlund, who decides at a very early age that he wants to become the greatest watchmaker that the world has ever seen.
Jag heter Henning Karlsson och jag har varit verksam i företaget i 73 år. Jag började den 18 mars 1940. Och arbetsuppgiften var då att gå ärende på alla nivåer. Och tillse att det var utrymme för personalen att tvätta sig. Och det var på det viset att handsvett var påtförbjudet. Därför att då blir det beläggning på de små urdetaljerna. Så att man måste fixa till att man är torr och ren om händerna.
Well, my name is Lennart or Len Borgström. I used to be the owner of Abu. In Sweden. My grandfather's name was Carl August Borgström. And my father's name was Göte Borgström. And my name is Carl Göte Lennart Borgström. So I got the name both from my grandfather and my father. There was a guy named Henning Hammerlund.
Han bestämde sig redan som en liten skolgrabb och ägnade sitt liv åt finmekanik och urmakeri. Han förstod också att man måste ha kunskaper i ämnet om man ska komma någonstans här i livet.
After much insistence on doing an apprenticeship in nothing other than the highest level of engineering at the time, Henning's father, Axel Hammerlund, took him to Ängelholm to meet with a one-man specialty watchmaking shop that he knew of there. Young Henning would spend the next 16 years studying all of the finest points of Swedish pocket watch craftsmanship, general business, and even several languages.
Nu hade den där lilla gossen hunnit att bli 29 år gammal. Och nu kände han att han hade kunskaper för att förverkliga sina ungdomsdrömmar i en svensk fickurfabrik. Det var ju mycket spännande. 1887.
He walked down the railroad. There was a railroad going through Svängsta in those days. And he found this very nice spot, and he could buy the lot there at a very reasonable price. So he decided to start the first Swedish watch-making factory.
Men nu hade ju Henning Hammarlund hunnit att bli 30 år. Och nu tyckte han att det var arbetsamt att jobba dygnet runt. Då kom det en urmakare ifrån Kristianstad som hette Carl August Borgström. Och när han klappade på porten vid Halda fickurfabrik, då blev han mött av Henning Hammarlund.
The first products were pocket watches. They're beautiful pieces and they were real gold, real silver. And in those days people had their watches in their pocket and they had a cover.
After 10 years of teaching his fellow workers at Hamelin's Holda Watch Company, Carl August Borstrom is promoted to the Assembly Department Manager, and the small company's dedication to precision watchmaking quickly takes off. Having won several gold medals at the Chicago World Exhibition in 1893, and again when it was held at Stockholm in 1897.
So that's when Hamelin decided to go into taximeters also. So my grandfather designed the first Halda taximeter. In those days, the taximeter was sitting outside the horse-driven cabs like in London.
Och den befattningen den hade Carl August Borgström fram till 1920. Då hände det märkliga att Halda fikusfabrik gick i likvidation. Det berättas att Henning Hammarlund han var inte särskilt intresserad av företagsekonomi. Han delegerade ekonomiskötseln till en annan person som tydligen hade kunskapsluckor inom sitt verksamhetsområde.
And when the company went into bankruptcy, they had also started to make typewriters. My grandfather Carl August bought these watch part because he couldn't afford to buy anything else. Moved into a chapel on the other side of the river and converted that to the factory.
Den 28 februari 1921 startade Carl August Borgström upp det här lilla företaget.
The first thing he then did was to try to bypass his own patents and make a new taximeter. And that's how ABU started under the name AB Urfabriken.
So while continuing to produce handcrafted pocket watches and develop new patents on taximeters, ABU also started a venture into measuring the length of telephone calls.
You measured the length of a telephone call in periods which were 3 minutes. They were used all over the world by telephone companies.
Och då, de som hade pengar, de sa ju det, jag tar en ny 3 minuter. Medan de som hade ont om pengar, som saknade medel, de fick varva ner, avveckla samtalet och lägga på. So what about that time?
And so it was that these early AB Urfabriken taximeters and Telor models would be the first ABU products to bear the record name.
One of the main products for the ABU company was the taximeters, mechanical taximeters. They were produced here and sold all over the world under the name of Record, which then has become a name that the company used also for casting reels.
Ja, nu är vi framme vid 1934 och då avled företagets grundare är Carl August Borgström. Och sonen Göte Borgström hade hunnit och blivit 30 år gammal. Och nästintill självskriven chef för det här lilla företaget satte Göte sig ner med sina medarbetare och konstruerade rekordtaxametern modell 39. Och den var vid det tillfället världens minsta taxameter och därtill en alldeles utomordentlig skapelse ur kvalitetssynpunkt innehållande 800 detaljer. Och allt såg mycket lyckat ut. Men då kom det ett nytt problem. Kriget bröt ut 1 september 1939.
No export of taximeters, no import of taxicars.
Och den här stora satsningen syntes meningslös.
So he was sitting there with a lot of tools and parts and debt way over his head.
Vad skulle man nu ta sig till?
So it was a matter of using the Murrum River to drown yourself or to get inspiration to do something different. It's probably the most significant thing to the company. Had it not been for the Murrum River, it's very questionable whether my father had his interest in fishing, and even my grandfather fished in the Murrum River. And as he was a fisherman, he made the decision to make fishing reels. There were no fishing reels made in Sweden in those days.
Och då började de här fantastiska urmakarna och konstruerade de första svenska spinnrullarna rekord 15, 16, 17 och 1800.
Fathers and sons have long played a role in not only Abu's history, but in the sport of fishing in general.
Hi, my name is Bud Martin. This is my son Bradley. I live in Jackson, Mississippi. Been fishing all my life. Look forward to fishing some more with Bradley. His first fishing rod, he won at a little fishing tournament at a little sports store. And I've got pictures of him, and he won. I just didn't tell him later that there weren't any other children there to participate.
You know, we had two ambassadors, and his was the black one. Mine was the red one. The black one was off limits forever. One day I stepped up and said, I'm going to use the black one, you know, and somehow I got it and it was here. Even though they were almost the same, one just the color, that one was my granddaddy's. That one meant a lot. That one was serious. I guess I probably took it because I thought that one would catch the fish.
He was 15.
Yeah, about
15. And it was still beautiful. So he thought it was brand new. So off he goes with my dad's reel to fish with it, which is fine. I mean, hey, you got to learn.
It was one of those things that's like, well, it's kind of like it just happened. The fish flopped off the hook, landed in the bottom, landed on the deck, flopped and kicked the reel out of the boat. And it was just like, what are the chances? What, seriously, like, how does that happen? But it happened, of course. I've got a reel that I'm not supposed to really have or use or lose, and it happened, and it was gone, and the fish was gone, and the reel was gone, and I'm sitting there going, oh, that's, now what? It was like, we went looking for it that day and was like, there's no way. It was like 15 feet down in the mud. And if I can remember correctly, it was a couple days and it was just like, small issue here. And of course, I probably, long drawn out story of how it wasn't my fault, you know. We'd dive down with spotlights and big bags, trying to spotlight at the bottom of this muddy fishing lake. A couple years later, the lake had dropped like a good 10 feet, and it was like, we might actually have a chance of finding it. But then again, it's been 2 years, so it could be under 6 inches of mud.
I had a garden rake with a 20-foot rope tied to it and tossed it over the back of the boat and hoped the tines went down this way and you would pull. So in the John boat, he was in the front, I was in the back. He would throw his rake off the front, it hit the bottom, he'd pull the boat forward. I threw my rake off the back, start pulling, it'd pull us backwards. So we were just back and forth, all over the lake.
You know, find this tree, find that tree. I remember exactly where it went in the water. You know, of course it went straight down. It was right there. All you gotta do is just get it, right? You know, throw the rake right there and get it. No, I had put my rake down. One of them was more like a small pitchfork. And he was like, all right, just one last throw. And I said, okay. He throws it. If I remember correctly, you know, the whole rake's in the water. It's not like this targeted, you know, here, I'm gonna put it right there. It's like, here, just launch the rake and pull it back with the rope. Pulls it, gets hung up, and the tip of the rod comes out of the water, just stands up. And I hear him, and yeah, I was like, what? There's no way. There is no way.
Pulled her out of the water, just like.
Hoping that the reel was still on it.
The reel was still on it. And it was.
It was.
It was all there, covered in mud and gunk, and looked like a beaver had chewed on it. But it was all there.
It was there, and we took pictures, and of course called all our friends that had spent time over the years looking for it.
We found it. Generation after generation, it's held up, and I'll be fishing with it today.
Då kom jag med i firman här den 18 mars 1940. Abu-museet är levande och ni ser att urmaskinerna fungerar som de gjorde förr i tiden. Här ser ni Holger Wikström. Han har jobbat här i över 50 år och han blev verkmästare med tiden. Och där sitter jag själv som 13-åring och det har gått 73 år sedan dess. Tiden går fort.
I definitely think that it was a very genius decision of my father to go into fishing tackle. He fished, loved to fish. And when you combine a hobby with your work, that's wonderful.
My name is Klaas Klaasen, and my alias is Svart Sonke. I'm a professional lure builder. My main target of fish is pike, redfin perch, sander, salmon, and musky. Abu Garcia had launched a new type of jerk bait that was based on their old high-low wobbler. It was called high-low jerk, and I helped them out to develop 6 colors, I think, on that lure. And that was how it all started out. For me, my family is very important. When I was younger, my grandpa taught me to fish, and all my lures are named after my kids. My father was a pretty famous painter. His father was, and my brother is, and yeah. So I really enjoy making my old things, you know? It's more like a dream come true, you know? Living the dream. It's pinched my arm, you know?
I started working at the company in the summertime, I think when I was 10, 12 years old. And the guy who is now in charge of the museum, he was one of the naughty boys in those days. When I looked away or I was working, they would throw little parts at me. And then they would hide behind the machinery so I wouldn't see who they were.
När Borgström åkte till Stockholm till grossisterna och presenterade de här första spinnrullarna så blev han mottagen med öppna famnen. Därför att det var importstopp och sportfiskegrejer.
He had set up meetings with 3 different wholesalers.
Och de frågade ju hur stor kapacitet de har i företaget. Och det var ju svårt att veta hur man skulle lägga sig.
He came to the first one in Gothenburg and he said I would be interested in 5,000 reels. So already that was a shock to my father. It was one first customer, 5,000 reels. But I want them with my own name, which was Per Beko, Paul Berghaus and Company, P. Beko. And my father had no experience and didn't know anything about marketing at those days. He just felt that that's great. The main thing is that I can get started. So he went to the second one, who was also in Gothenburg. And the first thing, the buyer there said, how many could you produce? Reels. Well, I've already sold 5,000, he said, but I can probably produce another 10,000. We'll take those 10,000. He said, now my father was in a better position, he said, that now, but you will have to do that under the record brand because that's what we're going to use. So he never got a chance to see the third wholesaler because he'd already sold way more than he thought that he would be able to produce.
Och det blev ju en väldig rush. Och han kom hem här till företaget och berättade för oss att in i verkstaden. Vi frågade ju, hur blir det? Får vi något jobb? In i verkstaden och jobba på. Vi måste producera stenhårt nu för att kunna leverera det jag har lovat.
If you ask any Swedish person, they know what Abu Garcia is. And they have all some kind of relations to it. Their grandfather, their cousins, mother, whatever. It's a very strong bond in Sweden.
But such strong personal connections between avid anglers with lures and reels has also long been an international affair for Abu, stretching out to wherever families share the joys of fishing.
My name is Steve Murphy. My dad lived in Port Bolivar, which is off the coast of Galveston. It's a small island out there. It's a big sandbar is what it is. Galveston is a pretty busy shipping port, so there's a lot of ships that come through there. But what's interesting about it is the amount of water that moves through there. The fishing is amazing. The redfish, the trout, and other species that, you know, people fish for.
There's a fish.
Got him?
Yeah. Where's that net guy?
My favorite is probably redfish. The weekends that I would drive over to my dad's, and as he got older and he was unable to take the boat out, we would spend time down on the beach near his house. When I'd go visiting, we would always talk about the chance or the threat of a hurricane coming in to the island. And he always blew me off. He said there hadn't been one there in 30 years. Ever since he's lived there, they've always bypassed him. So in 2007, Hurricane Ike was out in the Gulf of Mexico, coming from Florida and was headed to Corpus Christi. But my dad was had started suffering from Alzheimer's, and just prior to that, it had actually starting to affect him more and more. And on September 9th, he had a massive heart attack and passed away. He fished up until I would guess probably a week before he actually passed away. What was bad was I would get, when I would talk to him on the phone, my stepmother would get on the phone and say, "You've got to come over here and talk to your dad, because he drives down to the beach and he gets down there and he doesn't know how to get home." And he was going fishing. He fished all the time. He was always on the beach fishing. The hurricane hit, I think it was a Friday night that it came in and wiped out the island and devastated the island, and the house and all the belongings and everything were gone. And I would say probably 4, 5, 6 months before anybody could get back on here. And even then, I don't know how long it took them to find anything, because it was scattered so much. And we're trying to figure out, it was right next to this blue house. So you're actually on what used to be my dad. Joe Murphy is who used to own it. And I'm his son, Steve.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Nice to meet you. The first time that I came back down here, you know, the house wasn't here. And actually, I came down to meet a lady that had my dad's remains. And that she had finally come back, and I got the remains from her. My oldest brother, who had lived on the island near my dad, went back to the island once they had opened it up and found a bunch of items, you know, that he had. And part of those were the Abu Garcia reels. You couldn't distinguish the model or even the color of the reels at the time. They were, apparently they had been buried, and that silt just was like glue stuck to them. Well, he kept them, and about 2 years later, he gave them to my brother Mike. And my brother Mike had met me at Corpus Christi to go fishing with me. And when we got there, he gave me the box of reels that my brother had found. When I brought them home, I think it was a weekend or two after that, I decided I'd go ahead and see if there was anything about the reels that were usable. And I took them apart and took the first one apart, and it was absolutely just packed with mud and silt. But I cleaned them up, and each one of them that I took apart and cleaned up and put back together, they looked like they were just some reels that, you know, I found. They were in perfect working condition. My dad's had some of these reels for, I know, many years. I know he's been fishing with them as far back as I can remember. And as he used those reels, and he's passed them down to me and my brothers, and we will use them. And I have a son that loves to fish. When we go fishing, he loves to use, you know, my reels, and I know they'll be passed down to him one day.
Så att man kunde inte vara verksamma här länge. Man fick bygga nytt 1943 och flytta härifrån.
The first record casting reels were created in around 1941. Those reels were built in the old chapel. Until 1943, we built another factory on the other side of the road, which is still the existing factory, which has been expanded a number of times.
Det blir ny teknik, ny personal och en väldig ruff. Man åkte då ifrån ett personantal på en 15-20 personer. Ja.
Jag heter Anneli Sandin och jag har jobbat här i 39 år. Jag var 15 år när jag började här. Mina arbetsuppgifter här är bland annat här i monteringen och inne på automatlinen.
Ja, jag heter Håkan Sänket och jag har jobbat här på ABU i 25 år. Började på verksavdelningen. Och senare tiden har jag jobbat med styrda maskiner som operatör och programmerare. Ja, jag jobbar ju här för att jag är ju intresserad av själva produkten. Fiska själv, och det är ju tack vare den anledningen som man har stannat här så länge.
Ja, det betyder mycket för mig. Jag träffade min man här på ABU. Det hade jag inte gjort om inte ABU hade funnits kanske.
Well, there was a fashion in the 50s, 60s, 70s. They had international tournaments where you could see how the guy who could cast the farthest, there were world champions in this sport. As we were tournament casters, we wanted to make a reel that tournament casters could use for distance casting. It was my father's design, the 2100. It has no lever wind, but it was the first reel with a centrifugal brake.
Record 2100 sport version was the preferred reel for the tournament casters. So the people who wanted this specific reel was from casters throughout the world, from the US, from Japan, from Europe, because there was by far the best reel in the world. There was nothing even close to it. So this reel here comes from my father. He did tournament casting for many years, and he was actually a very good distance caster, both single and double-handed rods. This specific reel, he won the medal in around 23 competitions between Eurovision Championship and Swedish Championship. It was as a gift, because he got sick, and he wanted to make sure that I had this reel. I've been carrying on the family dream of fishing tackle. He even has his name printed on the side, so I'm going to give it to someone in my family.
Abu's connection to the world of sport fishing competition is still seen today in both its own employees and the professional anglers that they often work with. And it seems everyone has a story to tell about what hooked them into a lifetime of fishing.
A summer when I was 9 years old, my family had rented a cottage in the archipelago. We went out every morning doing pike fishing. Everyone caught pikes except me. And on the last day, I went out to a rock pile and I did a long cast and reeled it in. And then I had a massive pike following the lure all the way into the shore, right between my feet, and it looked at me and said, and turned away. and that made me a fisherman, for sure.
My name is Patrick Svensson. I've been with the company for 29 years now, this September. Father worked also for Abu Garcia for about 45 years. You can say that I'm born and raised with a red ambassador in my hands. I've also fished some tournaments in the past, and in 2000 I became Swedish champion in salmon trolling. Yeah, being an angler myself, it helps me a lot in my daily work, because then I can understand what's important for the angler, and I know that a lot of people here at the plant do fish as much as they can, so they get a feel for what's important for the consumer.
Quality is so important for us, and I really learned that the first day when I started with Abu Garcia, and I've only been on the job for like 2 hours, and the telephone rings. And there was a person in the other end just starting to scream at me. He was so upset because he had taken his car and driven, 5 hours up to the north of Sweden to go fishing. And for some reason, his reel didn't work. So he had to go back again. So I really learned the first day on the job that, wow, quality is so important for us, for the consumers.
I like to catch catfish because I like to catch big fish. You know, there's nothing like it in fresh water. I don't baby my gear. I throw it around. I leave it laying around on the floor of the boat. You know, I drop it. My clients are always fishing with it, and you know, usually pretty abusive to it.
Göteborgsstrand var en mycket charmig person. Lisen Borgström, hans hustru, var en underbar kvinna.
I remember we went to the States together. He didn't speak a word of English, but he was loved by everybody. He was laughing his way around. He had a loud laugh.
Och jag fick vara med på deras sista färd genom att delta och bära dem till graven alltså.
You know, I'm just sorry that I didn't take more time to fish with him. And I was very much left alone to run the business.
Lennart Borgström, han hade ju utbildning. Han kunde språk. Och han gjorde ju de stora försäljningsreglerna i USA till exempel.
I always had the greatest contact with our customers. Our agents came to see us. They were guests at our homes. We were personal friends with all of those people. It was a big international Abu family.
The relationship with the US and Sweden is a close one. I mean, I travel here multiple times a year. It would be between 2 and 4 times a year, depending on what's going on.
We're developing bait cast reels. I guess the problems nowadays is the same as what they were 50 years ago. It's balancing features, cost, and ease of use for the angler.
Ah, you see this human hair? It's about 3 times thicker than the tolerance allowed in this machine. You can't build a strong house on a weak foundation, you know.
I don't look at it as a USA and Sweden parts of the team. I look at it as an Abu team, because each person and each part of the team is integral in the success of the brand.
The advantage we have today is we have a software that allows us to do simulations, for instance, that they didn't have back then. Back then they had a drawing board and a pencil. Nowadays we can design and work on a reel 24 hours per day, because we have engineers in the US, we have engineers here in Europe, and we have engineers in Asia.
Originally, the record reels, they were more or less handmade. You couldn't take a spool from one reel and put in another, even if it was the same number. They were grinded or polished into the right dimensions.
So they were doing that for quite some years, and then in 1952, when Åke Mörvall came on, he, you know, helped the company to even raise the quality standards.
He was first a workaholic. If you gave him a problem, he wouldn't sleep nights until he'd solved it. Every drawing that we have him on every product was changed so that everything could be mass produced.
When designing for automatic assembly, you always have to consider that it's going to be a machine that's going to assemble it, and it wants to assemble it from the top. So it wants to put part A in, and then part B and C and so forth. So they have to be very, very simple to put together, and that's one thing that the anglers appreciate today, because if a machine can put them together, that means that they're very, very easy to service also.
Abu Garcias are relatively easy to actually take apart and clean and service. Some of the other reels that I worked with, as a matter of fact, I worked some other level wine reels that are put together and assembled so delicately, and you've got these tiny pieces and parts, and I've lost a lot of pieces and parts just trying to take these things apart. If you take apart the reel, you clean it up, you know, you put it together correctly, this reel is going to last you forever.
I think it's technology and simplicity at the same time. I think that's what the brand was really built on.
It was an advertising manager that we had, his name was Eric Swan, who came up with the name Ambassador.
So in 1952, they changed the name from Record to Ambassador.
When I was little, it was like a treasure. I would never get one, but maybe one day.
The first Ambassador reel was the Ambassador 5000. This was the first reel in the world made of aluminum. The reason aluminum was chosen was that as it was slightly bigger, if we had made it out of brass like most reels, it would have been very heavy. And then we had all kinds of colors available. So we made one red, one gold, and one green. And at a consumer show in Stockholm, the visitors were asked to vote for which color they liked. There was an overwhelming vote for the green. But my father had already fallen in love with the red, so he decided that the Ambassador should be red. So much for market research.
As Abu's popularity and notoriety continued to grow around the world with the emergence of the Ambassador,
the name of Abu has long been associated with fishing adventure. On this quiet stream, these anglers are fishing Abu tackle for a very special sporting fish. And there it is.
So did a very special catalog of their offerings. Napok Niet, or in English, Tight Lines, was an extensive and highly anticipated fishing annual, full of articles, angling tips, and of course, Abu's full lineup of products.
Historically, I think a Napok Niet, or the Tight Lines catalog, has really been one of the major things that has helped drive our marketing, especially in the Nordic region.
I remember the first time I went into a tackle shop, and the first thing at the door was a big stack of the Tightline magazine.
I was on the distribution list, so I got the catalog every year. And for me, it was the one mail that I became every year. It was the catalog from Arbor, the Napolit.
I think you've really got to fast forward a little bit to more modern day.
We're developing a new product, try to stay current with what's going on the market. Look at the websites, the forums, for instance, see what people are talking about there.
And I think really what's changed a lot now is social media.
Although Tightlines was certainly a heavyweight publication for sport fishing enthusiasts all over the world, it was just the beginning of a wave of popular advertising as innovative in spirit as Abu's reels, lures, and rods. With such memorable creations as Miss Abu, a cardboard stand-up that showcased an actual rod and reel, the Record Fisking Competition, and the International Ambassador Club, of which Prince Bertil of Sweden was the principal patron. In fact, by 1963, the ambassador was not only a workhorse for out on the water, but even came in an extra special edition for the angler who had everything, known as the Ambassador Deluxe.
It was an antique case with a pure silver plate on it. It was partly gold plated, 24 karat gold. And my original idea was that we should sell that only in gift stores and jewelry stores. Of course, the sporting goods stores got crazy.
Up until around 1954, an American tackle distributor, Charles Garcia and Company, was only handling U.S. distribution for Abu's lures. Lures like the Hilo Wobbler, the Abu Reflex, and one of their best-selling lures of all time, the Toby. However, the Ambassador had gotten so popular at this point that Tom Link, the then president of Garcia, realized he could no longer afford not to distribute the Ambassador in the United States.
When Tom Link came over in connection with my wedding and convinced us that we should give him the Ambassador agency, he had almost been lynched when he told his reps in Texas that he had turned down the Ambassador reel.
But even after introducing arguably the world's finest casting reel, Abu was large enough now that there was a conscious need to be competitive in all emerging and trending markets. And one of the biggest trending markets was spinning reels.
Too small to feed the family. Yep, lucky for him.
But again, a roadblock with Garcia, as they are already carrying spinning reels for one of Abu's main competitors, the French brand Mitchell. Abu's focus was not only figuring out how to innovate a spinning reel that would set them apart from everyone else, but how to get those reels into the hands of anglers as well.
The first spinning reel we made at Abu was the Abu 444. And then we made the Abu 505, which was a great success in England and was great for light lines.
So this is the Abumatic 505, and this specific reel was given to me when I was six from my father. So it was my first fishing reel. I'm gonna keep it forever. So what's good with this is that you push the button, the line always comes to your finger and you're ready to go, ready to cast.
But we were never that strong in spinning except in Scandinavia. So we figured we had to also make a conventional spinning reel, and we tried to make one that would be better than anybody else. So we made the Cardinal. We had a Danish designer for the shape, so it was the first probably fishing reel designed by a professional designer.
The name Cardinal was introduced in the mid-60s, and the name Cardinal became almost as popular and well-known as the Ambassador name, almost.
Now, Garcia, because of their conflict with Mitchell, couldn't sell the Cardinal reel. So I turned to my friend Ralph Lafferty and asked whether they would be interested. And they were delighted and took the Cardinal and made a great job of introducing it in the United States.
We actually had to buy a new factory situated 150 kilometers from here, where we could produce those reels.
At its height, Abu had become one of the world's finest purveyors of fishing tackle. Their success and impact on Sweden had earned them not only the privilege of using the king's crest on their reels, but actually regular visits from the king himself, his queen-to-be, and a host of other very special and important visitors.
The king and what's now the queen, they wasn't married at the time. They came to see Len Borgström and his family, and they fished the Mörrum River. Because we have this cottage where we have a lot of exciting people visit every year. It's a small place called Ekeberg, sitting next to the river. And there's a lot of pictures there on the king and queen, and also the president of Finland. He was a regular visitor and a good friend to Len and Göte Borgström. Also the prince of Sweden, Prince Bertil, came on several occasions as well.
De utseendemässigt så var de ju väldigt lika. Men Lennart, han kanske var lite, vad ska vi säga, lättsammare på något sätt som jag minns honom. Och han kom ju hit där på museet med jämna mellanrum. Vi kan se här på ett foto här när han ut och fiskar med kungens fru. Jag sa till henne att får man göra så med drottningen? De kramar ju om varandra. Och då sa henne att det var hon som gjorde så med mig.
From the late 1960s to the early 1980s, the world of business began to change rapidly, drastically affecting privately owned companies like Abu.
It was the in thing in those days. Many companies, they should diversify. So Garcia got into guns, skis, bindings, tennis, hockey. And what happened was, of course, that happened to many companies. You have a business that you know, and then you add other businesses that you don't know anything about, and you're getting problem with these businesses. So you turn your back to the thing you know.
Actually, in the beginning, we had an idea that we should start using the Abu name all over the world. Also in the United States market, but we found out that the Garcia name was so well established and had such a big value in the US that it had been a catastrophe to try to change that.
We merged. I changed the company to Abu Garcia, the company name, to make a show that it was a different company. It was not the old bankrupt Garcia, it was a new company.
So we had to lay people off in rather big numbers, and many of them you knew personally, and still you had to tell them that they no longer could be a part of the company.
It wasn't just Garcia's recovery from bankruptcy that plagued Abu. Now, Abu Garcia. At the same time other manufacturers were looking further east for the cheapest production possible, Sweden's government was enforcing a very hefty inheritance tax, which would have dealt another financially crippling blow to an already increasingly difficult situation. So in 1975, 80% of Abu Garcia is sold to a Swedish investment company.
And I've been asked many times, would there have been a difference if the taxes in Sweden had not been so crazy as they were in those days? What would have been the difference?
Abu Garcia would see itself in limbo of true leadership under the short sell operations of one investment company after another into the mid-90s, until an American company known as Pure Fishing, a company with a very similar philosophy to the old Abu, steps into the picture.
Pure Fishing purchased Abu in, I think it was 1995. And really, I think it's been a very positive relationship on the brand. I think a lot of people look at a big corporate company or a bigger company purchasing a smaller company as being a very negative thing, but I think for Abu, it really helped.
Of course, even in a well-matched relationship, the first year of marriage is said to be the toughest.
Berkeley was very good at developing line and bait. They were not used to the complexity of developing fishing reels, so you could say it was a clash between two cultures. And I must say that we put out some products on the market that I'm not really proud of today. The positive thing about that is that everyone realized that you can't do like that because then you're going to go out of business. So I would say that the practice we have today is superior to many companies.
I think the philosophies are very similar. We focus on our consumers, on our customers, and make sure they're having a great experience on the water.
For me, for life, it's all about product. It's all about durability. It's all about giving the angler the experience that he's expecting from an Abu Garcia product.
Ja, det betyder väl att har man väl börjat här så kommer man inte härifrån. Nej, jag bara skojar. Nej, jag tänker på att köper man en ambassadör så har man den livet ut.
We have so many consumers that calls us that still are fishing with their 1950s ambassador reels, and there is nothing that will make them, you know, stop using ambassadors. It's really for life.
I think it's important that the round baitcast reels are being made here in Sweden because it's here we have the knowledge and the technology and the heart in building round ambassadors.
I think it's with you all the time, whether you're on the water or not. I'm always thinking about fishing. Don't create something that just to say you've created it when it's got no advantage when you're actually on the water.
A round reel will never be out of fashion. The new reel that you showed me the other day is a wonderful sign of both beauty and technology.
Ja, jag tycker ju att det ursprungliga ligger i botten för den höga kvalitet som finns på ABO-produkterna. De ska vara effektiva, de ska vara eleganta och det ska vara kvalitet och precision. Det är det grundläggande. Och det hörs ju på namnet, aktiebolaget U-fabriken, det gamla namnet. Och det nya är ju ABO Garcia på Fishing.
Casting, the reel is the key to the sport. This ambassador is an engineering masterpiece. It has an adjustable star drag for playing fish, a release to free the spool for casting, and a level wind. Slow motion shows the easy, natural movement of the wrist, arm, and shoulder. That's championship form, and Johnny Dykman is the world's champion.